from Cascade, Active Glands, and Resident Lunatic, I guess.
And Ron, who have you brought along with you on the phone here today?
We are talking to Milton William Cooper. He's at home there in the United States of America. He's a, I don't know, conspiracy theorist. He's on the air 5 nights a week on WWCR Worldwide Christian Radio, shortwave 7.435 kilohertz from 9 until 10 p.m. Pacific time. And I don't know, I went out and bought a shortwave radio just to listen to him, and as it turns out, he is being jammed at certain times, and I'm annoyed, so now we have him on the air for my own personal revenge.
So, Bill, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
So, who are you, first off, for the listeners out there in Radio Land?
Well, just an ordinary average guy like everybody else, but many years ago I spent some time in the service of my country and was trained and indoctrinated into the Office of Naval Intelligence, where I spent several years as an intelligence operative. And there I saw an awful lot of documentation that just told me that the world is not what the average person thinks it is. In fact, everybody out there is living in fantasy land and are very seldom ever told the real truth behind the scenes. And I decided I didn't want anything to do with that kind of deception, so I left the service about 5 years before I could have retired very comfortably upon everybody's tax dollars. And I've been researching the meaning of all of the documentation that I saw and everything that I learned while I was in Naval Intelligence for the last 20-some-odd years, and the results are just absolutely amazing.
One of the results that you've been studying is the Kennedy assassination.
That's correct.
You believe, or you have proof, that the driver of the limousine that Kennedy was in killed Kennedy, in fact.
No, what I saw is in documentation, a top secret document under an operation called Operation Majority, that the driver had killed President Kennedy. And that the act was plainly visible in a film that was withheld from the public. It described the weapon that was used, and the reason for his brain disappearing was to prevent an autopsy from discovering the real type of projectile and weapon that was used, which was a gas-operated or gas-powered, electronically operated assassination pistol developed by the Central Intelligence Agency, which actually fired an exploding pellet containing shellfish toxin. I mean, nobody could survive a hit like that. It was absolutely impossible that he could have lived, no matter where he was hit in the body with that kind of a weapon.
But you learned this while studying this. You were working for the military at the time?
Yes, I was working for the Office of Naval Intelligence, and I discovered that operatives of the Office of Naval Intelligence actually participated in the assassination.
And this is not the Zapruder film that you saw this on?
No, this was on hard documentation, paper copy. Then I began looking for a film that would show it, because the documentation said that it was plainly visible in a film withheld from the public. Well, it was in 1972 that I saw this documentation. It wasn't until 1988 that I was able to see a copy of the Zapruder film that appeared to show William Greer turning around and shooting the president, William Greer being the driver of the car, the Secret Service agent that the documents claimed had done it.
Okay, did you originally get that film from Lars Hansen?
No, I originally got the film from John Lear, who stated that he had obtained it from a CIA operative who was a friend of his. Well, that CIA operative who was a friend of his turned out to be Lars Hansen.
How about in a typical Zapruder film that people know? Can you actually see it happening? You know, they would play it often on the anniversary of the assassination of JFK. You're saying if you look closely at the driver, you can see him turning around and killing Kennedy.
Well, that's what it appears to be. That's what it appears to see. What you see in that film confirms what I saw in documentation, if what we're seeing in the film is correct. We have since obtained a first-generation copy of the original Zapruder film from a member of my intelligence organization from the government of the United States, and we've put that on the computer, and we've seen that they have literally scraped the emulsion right off of the film. So what appears to be William Greer turning around and shooting the president is actually, there's nothing there on the film when you look at it on a computer. So what they've either done is they've planted documents stating that William Greer killed the president and shown them to many people, not only me. I'm not the only one who saw those documents. while in the service of my country, and one other person who was never in the military, Linda Moulton Howe, was shown the same documents in the Air Force Office of Special Investigation headquarters at Kirtland Air Force Base by Sergeant Richard Doty. Stated the exact same thing, and the documents were from the same Operation Majority. So either it's true, and they've scraped the emulsion off the film so that you cannot see anything there, but you can tell that it's not a play of light, it's not reflection, they're hiding something, or they've either scraped the emulsion off the film to create something in our conscious that actually didn't happen. We're not exactly sure what. But one thing it proves beyond any shadow of any doubt whatsoever that they've never been able to prove conclusively before is that it definitely was a conspiracy, because whoever doctored the film was a part of the assassination group, and they're trying to hide something or lead the public astray.
Now, Mr. Cooper, you have a degree in photography, don't you?
Yes, I did.
From where?
From Long Beach.
Long Beach. So, Grant, as we're talking here to William Cooper. Where are you right now?
I'm in Arizona. I live in Arizona.
Somewhere in Arizona. And we also have here Ron from the local band Cats Game. And you're on the Non-Voided Human Serviette Show. You mentioned that the driver, Greer, turned on to kill Kennedy. Do you believe there are any other shots fired? Like, was he working in tandem with people?
Well, I think there were several shots fired. That's obvious. But I believe that most of the shots were fired from the front, not from the rear. No shots were fired from the sixth floor of the depository building. Lee Harvey Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination, except that he was a patsy, in fact. And we have a photograph of him actually standing in the doorway of the ground floor of the book depository building, watching the motorcade as it passes by. So we can prove conclusively that Lee Harvey Oswald was not even inside the building. In fact, he was in the doorway watching the motorcade pass by when the president was assassinated.
What happened to the driver of the Kennedy limousine?
We have no idea. We found documentation that said that he died in 1985. If you know anything about the intelligence community, that does not mean that he's dead.
How about other figures that were on the scene at the time, like that umbrella man? If you look at the Kennedy assassination, there's a guy holding an umbrella, and it was like a really nice day in Dallas. What was he doing with an umbrella?
Well, we believe that was the signal. See, once a shot is fired and the president is hit, it must go through to its conclusion. So the first shot, wherever it came from, and it had to come from the front because it hit him in the throat and there was no exit wound, that shot hit the president. The man standing there on the curb saw that, opened the umbrella. That signaled everyone who was involved in the assassination that the president had been hit. That meant that no matter what happened, he could not be allowed to escape alive. You see, because if he had escaped alive and lived, then he could have spent the rest of his administration hunting those people down and hanging them by the neck until dead.
So they were hoping to kill him with the shots that were fired safe in the grassy knoll, but they didn't, so the driver had to finish him off.
Well, that's exactly what it looks like.
And how about Mrs. Kennedy? And she hasn't come forward because she's just afraid?
She never could come forward. Number one, at the time, the people who were involved in the assassination of her husband were surrounding her children. Her children were in their care, and were in their care for many years thereafter. So,
did the Kennedy family receive kickbacks for the loss of their son?
We have traced payments to the Kennedy family made by an officer from the Coast Guard station of Peanut Island across the property boundary under the Kennedy property. Suitcases of money were delivered to the Kennedy family for approximately 6 years following the assassination. So we believe that the Kennedy family were convinced that whatever reason their son was assassinated was in the best interest of the country, and were paid off to keep their mouth shut.
Yeah, so whatever is going on here is obviously worth the loss of a son for money then.
Well,
as far as they're concerned.
Apparently they had their price, and that price was satisfied. Let's put it that way.
Have you heard of Dave Emery at all before, from Radio Free America?
No, I don't know anything about
Tom Valentine, obviously.
No.
Well, Dave Emery broadcasts every night on CITR from 10 to 12 on Sunday nights. He's also on KFGC, Los Altos Hills, Berkeley. And he believes in a lot of stuff, a lot of the white Russians that were in Dallas at the time, like George DeMora showed.
Forget all that stuff.
You don't believe any of Dave
Emery? Forget all that stuff. If you've never been to Dealey Plaza, take a trip. John F. Kennedy was killed by the secret society, specifically the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry.
Well, now it's the perfect time for you to go into the Atlanta lecture video that you've just finished.
Just a second, Ron. We're not finished yet. Let's just get back to this for a second. That's the Kennedy assassination. So you're saying Radio Free America, Dave Emery, he says a lot of stuff is based around the Galen Organization. Are you familiar with the Galen Organization?
Forget that.
Forget the Galen. Stop laughing, Ron. This is important.
Let me tell you something. Stop looking at the exoteric or what people are throwing out for you as bait and start looking at the esoteric, the real occult meanings of everything surrounding this assassination. Kennedy was assassinated in Dealey Plaza, which is in the shape of a truncated triangle. In other words, the top has no capstone. There is an eye in that triangle. It's the underpass under the railroad overpass. Okay? This is a well-known occult symbol for the Illuminati, or those who are illumined, or the guardians of the secrets of the ages. Dealey Plaza also has the four quarters of a Celtic or Druid temple of the sun in Dealey Plaza. It is an exact duplicate, although cut in four quarters, of the temple of the sun, which is the outer courtyard of the Vatican. There is also an obelisk in Dealey Plaza, cut into 14 sections, which is the symbol of the phallus of Osiris, the lost word of Freemasonry, the generative force, the light, Lucifer, which is the god of this secret society.
Okay, I mentioned Dave Emery earlier, and we're talking here to William Cooper. William, are you the only one, Bill, preaching these ideals?
I'm not preaching anything. I'm just telling people to open their eyes and look at what's there. Kennedy was assassinated on the 33rd parallel, the highest degree, the meritorious degree of the secret societies. He was assassinated on November the 22nd. You add November the 11th month with 22, you get 33 again. It also happens to be the anniversary date of the Pope's papal bull condemning the Knights Templar to torture by the Dominican monks under the Inquisition. You subtract the year 1307 when that papal bull was issued from 1963, and you get 666. Kennedy was shot in the head, the throat, and the back, the exact same wound suffered by Hiram Abiff in the Masonic initiation, which they have sworn to revenge.
How about the signing of the Declaration of Independence of the United States on July 4th, 1776? That all traces in there as well.
That all goes in there.
How about the Lincoln assassination? Are there any links to that? Are you into that as well?
Lincoln's been dead for a lot of years. The people who assassinated him are dead. Anybody that's following that around is wasting their time. We need to deal with today, not 100 years ago.
Okay, so is there anybody else that believes these things that you do? Are you the first one to bring this out, William?
I'm the first one who's ever looked at it. Everybody else is running around believing all these disinformation peddlers.
Who are they? Who are the disinformation peddlers?
They're all these people who write a new book every year with new evidence, with new this, with new that, all pointing in different directions, and one says it's the Mafia, and the other says it's the Galen Organization, the other blames it on the CIA. The truth is, it's members of all of those who belong to the secret societies.
How long have you been researching this?
For
20 years?
About
20 years, huh?
What other media exposure have you gotten?
Well, not very much, simply because people who play around with this and really try to get it out in front of the public eye usually end up dead somewhere.
You did get a clear in Flipside magazine, right?
Yes.
How much feedback from that?
Yeah, I got quite a bit of feedback. I was amazed that so many young people who usually aren't concerned about anything except getting in somebody's pants and getting high were really interested in what's going on and where their country is heading, and I was surprised by that because I didn't think that many young people were, and that pleased me quite a bit.
How about hard copy? Haven't been on any of those or any other future things coming up?
Hard copy was going to put on the Kennedy information, and 1 hour before we were to go on the air, they got a phone call from a top executive in NBC and told him if they put me on the air, they'd all be fired. So that was the end of that.
How can a secret be kept so long? I mean, there has to be some botch-ups along the way.
It's pretty easy when you think of who owns NBC in the first place. And
well,
they supposedly have been building UFOs.
You're looking at it in the wrong way, guys. Normally, secrets can't be kept this long, and even though that they have been kept, there have still been leaks. And there always will be leaks when people are involved with anything.
And I guess you're a leak.
That's correct. But what you're looking at is not just a bunch of guys that decided to assassinate the president. You're looking at an ancient organization that goes back in history for some 6,000 years, which has blood oaths, which is, in fact, a religion, and everybody who belongs in it believes wholeheartedly and completely in what they're doing, and that's the real reason why the secret can be kept. They're promoting a religion with blood oaths that they'll be murdered if they ever reveal the secrets.
How about a Canadian link? Are there any Canadian links to this secret?
Absolutely. Just walk around in your own town, and pretty soon you're going to bump up against a temple without any windows that says the Masonic Lodge, Masonic Temple, Freemason Umpity Ump, whatever.
Well, the one on Agnes Street, New Westminster there.
How about Brian Mulroney, our Prime Minister? Is he aware?
Absolutely.
And he just quit, after he signed NAFTA, and that essentially, created Kingdom One of the New World Order, and then he got the hell out, just after Joe Clark did, you know?
Sure, so a new guy can come in and say, well, it's not my fault, you know, continue on and do his part.
And actually, on Canada AM last week, on Wednesday morning, he actually said that he was going to move back to Montreal to pursue religious beliefs.
That's exactly right.
So what should people do with these Islamic colleges? Should they bomb them, Bill?
No, I don't advocate violence. I advocate dealing everything within the law. But you have to realize you can put a lot of social pressure on these people. You can just socially ban them from everything in the community. Don't talk to them. They come in your store. Don't serve them.
It's very easy.
Don't invite them to parties. Don't talk to them. Just shun them.
Do you have to shake their hand and have them pressing on your second knuckle and tickling your palm to find out who they are? Or?
No, all you got to do is go down to Masonic Temple when they have their meetings and see who goes in and out.
Take a video camera?
take a video camera. Play it on local access TV and expose who these creep destroyers are, because they're destroying society.
Okay, Ron, this is not a comedy show. This is serious. And we do have a question from another station member here, Bill, to pose towards you. And A.O. Chapman joins us now. A.O.?
Hello. I have a few questions, Bill.
Sure.
And I'd like to ask, first of all, if you've read the book, The Holy Blood and the Holy Grail.
Yes, I have.
What is
that book, first, A.L.?
It's a book written, I guess, about 3 or 4 years ago now. And it, among other things, talks about, I'm trying to encapsulate it.
It opens up part of the picture. What it's talking about is a portion of the reason for the secret society's existence today. And that is to guard the bloodline of those who supposedly, with the secret societies believe, have the divine right to rule. And they are preparing in secret one of these members of that family to be the charismatic political and religious leader of the world
right.
in the New World Order.
So you feel that book was pretty much on the line.
Made a lot of mistakes, and they didn't carry it to its fulfillment. They left a lot of guesswork up to the reader, but they gave the reader enough clues that if they wanted to do their own research, they could come up with the answers themselves anyway. The problem is most people are so damn lazy they'll never get off their butt and look up anything.
Right. Okay, one thing we haven't really got into that much today, I guess, is some of your stuff that you've written about MJ-12. And I'd like to ask, the first stuff I ever read that came across from you was...
What is MJ-12? That UFOs?
That is regarding the UFOs. The first stuff I ever came across of yours was something called The Secret Government, that I think is dated from 1989.
Yeah, A.O. Chapman, in the other room here, Bill, he gave me a Xerox photocopy manuscript of yours. It was, really cryptic. It was, passed around. People were, showing it to each other and creating all this furor. But then I saw you in Slipsliding, and I found out you really were a real guy.
Oh, yeah?
I'm curious to know, in one excerpt from that, I remember reading about you speak of General Forrestal being, murdered.
Well, he wasn't a general, he was Secretary of Defense, and he was murdered, there's no doubt about that. He was murdered by
they threw him out a window and hung him by a bedsheet.
Yeah. And later on they changed it to say that his bathrobe belt was wrapped around his neck, but that was all made to look like he had committed suicide.
Right. Now, one thing that you, I remember stated in the secret government paper that I read was that the very last page, I believe, stated some idea or some idea of directions from you to keep aware of this stuff, but I'm curious to know, to get into it now, the whole ramifications of what's stated in that what's stated in that essay. Perhaps is the wrong thing to do right now, but I'm curious to know what actual
good phrasing, Ayo.
What actual things do you recommend to the average person to not only just keep aware but to protect oneself? Because I mean, a lot of this stuff is as strange as it sounds.
Well, number one, they have to understand that what's happening in the world today is not the result of any accident. It's the result of a long range plan that is coming into fruition now to break down the sovereignty of all nations, destroy all existing religions, and create a one world government, a one world religion, which will be totalitarian and socialist in nature. And with these,
what's wrong with socialism?
With these free trade agreements, they're in the process of destroying the middle class. What's wrong with socialism?
Yeah.
Socialism is for babies.
Okay.
Socialism is for people who cannot stand up and be responsible for their own actions, who cannot find their own job, who cannot feed themselves, who do not know how to...
Okay, what are you? What are you, Bill? Are you a Democrat or are you an anti-fascist?
Well, where they decide exactly what they want the goal to be, then they create two opposing sides, the clash of which will bring about the goal that they wanted, and the people will look at it as if it appeared by magic or by accident or that it was their own idea, so they are more readily accept it. This is not a theory. If you study history and really get in and study these organizations, you begin to see that it's fact.
Okay.
And can be documented.
Okay, Bill, I guess we're winding down the time here now. We're speaking here to Bill Cooper, and what would you classify yourself as, just in a couple words or less?
Well, I don't know what you mean by that.
Like, who are you? Like, if somebody said, I was listening to CITR and I heard Bill Cooper. He's,
I'm an average, ordinary person, just like anybody else, not any smarter, not any dumber, who's really seriously concerned about the future of our freedom.
And we also have in the studio here Ron from Cat's Game, who is a devout follower of William Cooper, and A.O. Chapman, who contributed some stuff. I'd like to move just a bit to some of the... Okay. I'd like to get now to some of the UFO stuff here. Well, not UFO, but is it my understanding, from what I've understood from seeing your videotapes, is it true that the U.S. Army possesses spaceships and will eventually fake an alien invasion in 1998 in which will unite the world under the leadership of Freemasons?
That's one of the scenarios.
Or the fact is that they could conceivably begin to attack us with this
technology
about a year before this star is supposed to reappear in the heavens. Therefore, everybody would be in such a state of panic that the Illuminatis could say that, oh, well, hey, if you guys are all panicking, look, here's our star. We said it would reappear. There it is. We are right. You are wrong, and we're taking over.
So how did the U.S. Army, who seems to be bundling a lot of stuff, how did they get a hold of alien craft, and how long have they had contact with them?
Well, first place, it's not the U.S. Army. It's secret agencies within the United States government that are under control of the secret societies. These things are being flown at a super secret test site called Groom Dry Lake or Area 51 in the state of Nevada. We have them on videotape, extensive footage both at night and daylight. They are what people normally call UFOs, flying saucers. Some of them are circular shaped, that are owned and operated by humans. They're either remote controlled or have human pilots. We're not exactly sure which. But they're not extraterrestrial at all. They're the results of a secret technology that were originally developed by the Germans during World War II, but not perfected to the state of being used as a weapons platform.
How did we get a hold of the technology? Like, did we meet aliens?
No, we took it from the Germans.
We took it from the Germans. Okay, how did the aliens... Have anybody in the U.S. government ever met any aliens?
We don't know if there are any aliens at all.
But wasn't there, an alien craft that crashed that you refer back to?
These aliens could have been created in something like a cryogenics lab in the future.
Bill, answer the question you're wrong? Okay.
Sorry, John.
Oh, thanks very much. Oh, so, Bill, where the alien craft ever crashed, landed?
We don't know. We know that the government has set up a scenario where there is evidence that seems to point that something crashed, which has been interpreted as an extraterrestrial craft with dead extraterrestrial bodies. But these could have been monkeys with their ears and tail cut off and surgical intervention done to their eyes, and who knows what it was.
Okay, how did the Germans get this technology then?
They developed it with their science.
So, so you're saying, well, just moving something a bit closer to home here,
Let me put it this way for you so that you'll understand it a little better. governments cannot exist unless the people feel threatened. The primary job of a government is to give the people a modicum of safety. The United States government was formed by a union of the states for their mutual benefit and protection. Okay? Now, to have a one-world government and tear down all the national boundaries, you have to instill the people of the world with enough fear that they're willing to give up what they used to be loyal to and join with something that's new that they don't know what it's going to be. What better way to do that than if the Earth were attacked or invaded by some other species from some other planet, whether real or imagined?
Okay, what about abductions? Here on the North Shore, well, in Vancouver, B.C., there's something for the North Shore News here, Sunday, February 23rd, 1993. It says, close encounters of the North Shore kind, 9 sightings in the past year prompt UFO researchers to look for alien hotspots. And in it, it talks about abductions and alarm sensors going off and dogs hearing whining and people getting radiated. What do you...
You got to be careful now. Dogs can't talk, so nobody knows what dogs hear, number one. Number two, most so-called ufologists or UFO researchers are blithering idiots and wouldn't know how to do any research if you sat down and taught them for a year. And number three, if you start looking into the actual research and development of brainwashing and mind control techniques by the United States, Great Britain, Canada, the Soviet Union, and others, and if you'll look at the mind control experiments and the actual lobotomies that were performed on people in hospitals in Canada, you'll see that this alien abduction thing is probably the most sophisticated and successful mind control operation ever conducted in the history of the world, and it's designed to make us believe that we're being threatened by some other species from some other planet so that they can have their one world government.
But didn't you say in one of your papers that there was an agreement that aliens were allowed to pluck people from Earth?
Nope. You see, this is what happens. People don't read what I write. What I said was, this is what I saw in documents when I was in Naval Intelligence.
So you're saying there are no UFOs out there, probably?
No, that's not what I said. UFOs are real. I can prove that at least some of them are owned and operated by humans here on this Earth.
Okay, they're humans, but there's no alien ones.
We don't know.
So you don't know?
I don't know if aliens exist or not, but I will tell you this. In 1917, John Dewey said this in 1917. What better way to unite all humanity in a one-world government than if we were attacked by some other species from some other planet?
Wasn't E.T. based on a true story? E.T.?
If what I saw in government documents when I was in Naval Intelligence is true, then yes. If not, it's just another part of the conditioning of our collective consciousness to accept the reality of something that doesn't exist.
And we've been on the moon since 1948 as well.
Yeah, what I'm trying to tell you is nobody really knows, but whatever the truth about UFOs is, it's being used to make us give up our freedoms and join in a one-world totalitarian socialist state, and that's what we better be careful of.
How about the Hubble telescope? Does that play into this at all?
I have no idea. All I know is what they said about it not being tested before it was launched is a lie. The government never does anything without testing every step thoroughly 6 or 8 times.
You have a question.
Mr. Cooper, I'm not quite reading in the secret document, in the secret government document that I read of yours. It's been a while since I read this, so maybe you can find it.
Maybe
right.
An alien krill, right?
Exactly. And you said you saw photographs of that alien. Are you tracking those photographs up with just... That may be part of the conspiracy as well? Or?
It certainly could, because not too long ago it appeared in the newspapers in the United States, and we verified it in research, that Walt Disney and the Walt Disney Studios were involved with projects with the intelligence community, and Walt Disney was a 33rd degree Freemason, and most of his executives and people who worked in his corporation were 33rd degree Freemasons also. Mm-hmm. We also found in 1958 and in other years where they had symposiums investigating, with scientists present, investigating the possibility of colonizing the moon and other planets, that Walt Disney representatives were heavily in attendance.
And also, I recall reading in the same document about the, I believe it was, you stated it was a holographic film of the crucifixion of Christ.
I stated that those documents said that that existed, but I never saw it.
You never saw it, okay.
Okay, William Cooper here. Referring back, we're speaking to William Cooper, just an average guy phoning someone from Austin, Texas.
Not average at all.
Not an average, Ron says. But according to this report about UFOs, I'm sorry to dwell on this again, but it says there are several different kinds of UFOs, it says in this article. They range from the bizarre religious people who are trying to put their point or view across to ex-CIA people. We're not fence-sitters, this guy says. Now, you mentioned you're religious before. Were they referring to you when they say they range from bizarre religious people who are trying to put their point of view across?
I can't speak for that author. I have no idea who it is, but I'm not a bizarre religious person.
This was the guy...
You haven't heard me preaching anything, have you?
No, I haven't. Well, maybe some interesting things. But this guy's Lorne Goldfather from the Texas-based Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence.
Never heard of him, never heard of his organization, and how can he have a center for the study of extraterrestrial intelligence when nobody even knows if such a thing exists?
Well, what did the music...
Just that fact alone makes him sound more like the blithering idiot than anybody else.
What type of music do you like, Bill?
I like all different kinds of music, and I play all different kinds of music on my radio show, all the way from rap to classical.
I heard Chuck Berry
people can tune into you if they want.
Oh, yeah.
Do you use shortwave? Where is that on the dial?
First, you have a shortwave radio, and you got to have a good antenna. The most important thing about listening to shortwave is the antenna, not really the set.
And the copper wire works best.
But they can tune in at 7435 megahertz. That's WWCR, and it's worldwide, 100,000 watts. My show is heard in every city and every continent of the world, and occasionally they jam my program because the information that I'm putting out is really hurting a lot of their efforts.
Yeah, it seems like whenever you really begin to get to the heart of the matter, the program seems to leave the air completely.
Has anybody taken your call, aside from Ron here, from Cats Game? Hi, Ron, how are you?
Not bad.
Ron, has anybody influential in the American government taken, or any officials, low-ranking ones, been converted from what you were saying and are working on stuff? Like, do you have any, like, Arsenio Hall, perhaps?
Arsenio Hall, are you serious? Get real. Arsenio Hall, if anybody's living in fantasy land, he is. He wouldn't know reality if it smacked him upside the head. He is a good entertainer, and I enjoy watching his show, but let's not get him confused with reality here.
Is there anybody that's come, anybody in the entertainment industry, or anybody that's come forward and agreeing with your stuff besides Ron from Cats Game?
No, let's actually direct this towards, like, let's say Oliver Stone here now. I don't want to regress, but did you attempt to contact Oliver Stone before he went into pre-production for the movie JFK?
That's correct. Attempted over and over again, hundreds of times, to contact him. Not only myself, but intermediaries and other people. He absolutely refused to acknowledge our existence or even speak to us. And when you watch his film, you'll see that what he's doing is blaming everything on our government. What he's saying, in effect, is constitutional government doesn't work, and that's a lie, in order to get us to be dissatisfied so that we'll accept the New World Order when it comes.
So do you think that the name Oliver Stone is like a pseudonym, and that Stone has to do with the actual basic teachings of the Freemason religion, what you were talking about?
Absolutely, and he must be a member, because he shows in his film that he knows who really killed Kennedy, and in the way that he does it, he's actually laughing at the rest of us.
Yeah.
When Garrison and Prouty are sitting on the park bench in Washington, D.C., and they're talking about why, and he says, that's the question, isn't it? Why?
So then
who had the power? Who had the opportunity? Who had this? Who had that? And then the camera moves back, and they become real tiny in the picture. In fact, you can barely see them, and there's one dominating scene. There's one dominating part of that picture, and that is the Washington Monument, which is the obelisk, the phallus, the lost word of Freemasonry, the lost loop.
There is an obelisk in sort of the front garden of the Vatican, is there not?
There is an obelisk in the Temple of the Sun.
These are Masonic things, right?
Well, that has to do with, Mr. Cooper, would you elaborate on what an obelisk is?
The obelisk is the symbol of the lost part of Osiris.
It's his penis, isn't it?
That's right. Chopped into 14 pieces, flung about the land. Isis went to recover him, could find everything but the generative part, the phallus, the penis. It's the symbol of the lost word of Freemasonry.
So we're to believe that this thing swam across the Mediterranean by itself and came up out of the water at the Vatican or something.
Okay, I just want to finish up on the UFO things here, Ron, for a second here, Ron from Cats Game. Now, you were in Vietnam. Weren't you? How come the United States government, okay, the people in control didn't use any UFOs in Vietnam or in the Gulf War to wipe out?
There were a lot of UFO incidents involved in Vietnam, and I believe they were testing the military or weaponry capability of the craft. Vietnam had UFO incidents from the very southern tip to the northern tip all the time.
They were known as NJA helicopters?
Well, when they were discussed in official dispatches or messages, the code word for UFO activity was enemy helicopter activity.
Didn't any of them crash and enemy get a hold of them?
Not that I'm aware of.
How about that also, that troop motivating drug? Are there troop motivating drugs?
There are all kinds of drugs given to certain units depending upon what their mission is. Some drugs are just to keep them awake for long periods of time. Some are to give them an artificial form of energy so that they can travel long periods, long distances, in short periods without collapse. Some are to give them a mental attitude so that they go into battle, they're not afraid. Drugs are used extensively to accomplish certain goals in the military and in the intelligence community. And will continue to be until the people get smart enough to put the lid on these creeps and stop them from all this stuff.
How about the RFK assassination? Sirhan Sirhan supposedly was hypno-programmed to kill Robert Kennedy. Are you into that at all?
Well, he was certainly hypno-programmed, but he didn't kill Robert Kennedy.
So there is
hypno-programmed. He was killed by a close-range shot from within 1 or 2 inches behind his right ear, and the only one standing in that position was a security guard named Caesar, who has since disappeared.
And so people can't, but so Sirhan Sirhan, can people be hypno-programmed?
Absolutely. As I said before, if you begin to study the developments in operational programs of brainwashing and mind control, you'll find that what they can do is absolutely incredible, will blow your mind, and will teach you that right now the possibility of total control over every human being on the face of this earth for every 24 hours of their lives is a distinct possibility in the very near future.
Therefore, it is true then that, like, Mark Lapine, who committed the Montreal Massacre, who was on the drug Prozac, also the fellow who went into, James Huberty, who did the massacre at the McDonald's, they were all on Prozac, and all their drugs came supposedly from the same place, and that the doctor's name has never been released because... Well, for obvious reasons, right?
Sure, this is correct. And I was lecturing about this. I told people that this was going to happen long before it happened. I wrote it in my book that there would be mass murders committed by ex-mental patients who were on the drug Prozac. It's just another one of my predictions that came true, but nobody seems to be paying much attention.
How about the Bermuda Triangle? Are you into that at all?
No. Let me make one thing perfectly clear here. I'm not into mysterious things or witchcraft or disappearing ships or anything like that. My only purpose, and the only reason I even began to do any of this, is because I believe that sometime in the near future we're all in danger of losing the affluence that we worked hard for. We're in danger of losing our personal freedoms and becoming somebody's slave in the New World Order. And that's the only thing I care about, that's the only thing I'm fighting, and that's the only reason I'm doing any of this.
And people can actually go and search out and find CD's UFO bases that are controlled by elements of the American establishment.
Not just the American. You see, we believe that the first flying discs were actually perfected in a remote area of northwestern Canada.
So are there any... Where can people find these...
Go research the AVRO Aviation Company.
And they can order your videotape, too. Maybe we should give your address right now, Bill William Cooper, if you could. And on your videotapes, which I actually saw, you do actually go to great lengths in one of them to show about the Kennedy assassination and how the driver did turn around and shoot Kennedy. And another one goes into a lot of the UFOs, and you actually going out there trying to find one of those UFO bases, and you get close to it, but they swore you away.
No, they didn't escort us away. We did photograph the craft flying both at night and in the daylight. They did harass us. They threatened us. Did all kinds of things. But I'm not easily scared, and I know my rights, so they were not successful.
One foot on the on the wrong side of that line, though, and like you said, they could shoot you or they could charge you.
That's correct. They have the right, and they have been ordered to use a deadly force if need be if you step across the line.
Okay, briefly, I would like to put
an address.
Just a second. It's a miracle. This gentleman is on the line here. What I would like to ask you is, on Project Red Light 2, you see that the spacecraft, they disappear from this time. Now, does that mean that they could possibly be carrying human beings either forward or backwards in time. And
that's exactly what it means.
And that's true, it would certainly explain
a lot of mysterious things that have happened.
It certainly would,
especially
the Roswell crash, because in the future it might very well be possible to sort of create some type of alien appearing being and then go back to 1948 and drop it in the desert there so that somebody on secret sightings or something like that can say, oh yeah, 30 years ago I saw an alien being, when in fact nobody knows that it actually did come from a human-made laboratory somewhere in the future and was dropped back there in order to create sort of a beginning of the panic that might happen within the next 3 to 5 to 7 years.
That's a possibility. With time travel, it would then be feasible to re-engineer the past to create a new future. And that is mind-blowing.
It's really hard to understand.
Okay, now, first off, this is live. This is the Nardwuar to Human Serviette show here, live today, the 26th of February, 1993, and we're speaking to William Cooper. No, this isn't a tape, as one caller phoned in and asked if it was. It isn't a joke. This is serious. And if people are interested and want further information on William Cooper, I'd say, first off, if anybody reads Flipside Magazine, the music mag from L.A., which is really great and features articles by KRK as well, there's a big piece that William Cooper contributed to that for the past couple issues. You can check that out, or you can write to William Cooper, and Mr. Cooper, if you could explain what you have and your address and phone number and whatnot, please.
Well, it's best just to call or write and ask for an information packet, and we'll send you a list of everything that we have and what we're doing. You can call my representative. His name is Stan. He's really a great guy. His number is 602-567-6109. That's 602-567-6109, or you can write to Stan, STAN, Post Office Box 889, Camp Verde. That's spelled V as in Victor, ERDE, Spanish for green, Arizona, 86322. That's Stan, P.O. Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322, and just ask for a packet of information and Stan will send you one. If you want it real quick, give him a call. It'll be in the mail tomorrow.
Well, thank you very much for speaking with us. We're just wrapping down here, and it's really interesting about all this UFO stuff. When I first heard about what you're doing, I thought you were saying, you know, aliens crashed, we stole their craft, and we have the technology, and people are allowed to be plucked from the Earth. But as you've told me now, that's wrong, right? From what you did not mean that.
My paper, the initial press release that I did was called Operation Majority, and it was a list of things that I could remember seeing pertaining to UFOs in top secret documents while I was in Naval Intelligence. The second document that I released was called The Secret Government, which, if what I had seen in those documents was true, and if what I'd been able to research was true, and that others had researched, and documents released under the FOIA were true, then it was, in fact, the history, as close as anybody's ever been able to write the history, of extraterrestrial visitation to this Earth. If not, it's what they want us to believe. At the beginning of that, I had a hypothesis statement saying that this is a hypothesis based upon this, this, and this, which has been taken off. And at the end, I had 5 conclusions. Number 5 was the fact that this could be the greatest hoax in the history of the world, designed to create an alien threat that does not exist to bring about a one-world government, which has also been removed.
Where can people find these UFOs in Canada? They just have to go out there and study or buy your video and find it? I mean, people want some proof. Where can they delve deeper besides from your stuff into other stuff?
Right after World War II, A.V. Rowe built a veritable city in northwest Canada to work on top secret aviation developments, one of which was the flying disc, which is called flying saucers or UFOs.
Which city?
Research A.V. Rowe. Find their secret test sites, and you'll be able to film these things flying in Canada just like I can film them flying here in the United States.
Yeah, actually, the flying disc, isn't it in the National, isn't it in the Smithsonian or one of the old, there's actual, I saw a documentary on it, and they said it was a failed craft. Well, I guess, according to you, it wasn't failed.
That was to convince the public that we humans don't have the technology necessary to build one of those things, which was a disinformation program called Project Snowbird.
Okay, who are the bad guys? Who are the bad guys just right off the bat? The Masons?
Well, nobody's really a bad guy. You got to understand that these guys aren't doing this because they're evil or they think that they're bad. They're doing it because they actually believe that it's the best for all humanity. But their assumption is wrong. Anything that has to be manipulated, Anything that has to be brought about by lies and deceit is inherently wrong in its premise to begin with. So they're fooling themselves. They believe that the rest of us are so stupid that we're just like cattle, and that's what they call us, and that they're the only ones with truly mature minds, and that they've got to bring all the rest of us under total and complete control so that they can run the world the way they want to, and they actually believe that there's going to be a utopia because of what they bring about.
I saw a flowchart that you did, I'm saying more specific, that like Barbara Walters was in on this, like who exactly is in on this? Who knows the secret?
Not all of these people know the secret.
But they're part of it.
But they're part of it, yes.
Okay. So who are some of them? I just want, like, for instance, like you said, you like Arsenio's show. Arsenio's show is probably produced by Columbia or whatever. And Columbia's, I mean, what are the actual specifics?
You're asking me for something that would take me a long, long time to tell you.
Any surprising ones?
It's been a fat half hour, I know.
Any surprising ones, Bill, that you could throw out there just for people in Canada? Like Safeway shopping malls, Woodward's?
Well, I don't have any idea what would surprise you, but I'll tell you this, that look for names and symbols. For instance, Mazda is the name of one of the ancient representations of the god of this religion. So when you look at corporations like Honeywell and you see that they have a European division named Lucifer and things like that. I mean, people out there cannot depend upon people like me or anyone else, and I always tell people this, that you cannot ever worship a leader. You cannot believe anything that anyone says, and everybody listening right now, and everybody in this world, in fact, if we're going to maintain our freedom, and if we're going to have a good future, everybody has to learn to do on their own individual initiative what I'm doing.
And Famer said, food for thought, grounds for further research.
That's correct.
So you're agreeing one thing that Dave Emery says of Radio Free America. Is that also Procter & Gamble? Because if you line up the Ramones and the Procter & Gamble symbol, it becomes 666. Is that part of it?
Watch for symbols of the sun and the moon. Procter & Gamble, the head of Procter & Gamble, was on a television talk show here in the United States, and he actually admitted that he had made a pact with the devil, and that's what made him rich. These secret societies actually worship the being called Lucifer.
Okay, winding up here, we have another question for A.O. Chapman.
One thing, Mr. Cooper, I just wanted to ask this before we run out of time here, is with all the things that I've read from your stuff, if the most nightmarish situation were to come true, from all the scenarios that you offer that may occur, what do you really advise to the average person? I mean, I recall reading the first time I ever read something of yours, which was that secret document, of the secret government essay you wrote. I felt quite paranoid after all that. I felt quite helpless.
Well, that's good. That's the defensive reaction.
Right, and so what do you prescribe as action to the person who now realizing this or now aware of it? What avenue should a person like me or anybody out there take?
Well, number one, they have to stop being deceived and learn what the truth is. Forget everything that you've ever been taught in your life, no matter who it was that taught it to you. Begin again, starting from scratch, doing real digging, real research, which is work, but it's also a lot of fun. And when you discover something that nobody else knows, it gives you a rush better than any drug that you could ever possibly take in your life. And learn what the truth is, because until you know what the truth is, there's nothing that you can do.
No,
that's number one, and that's got to be done. After you know the truth, and everybody who knows the truth, get together, band into politically powerful groups, and legally take action to change the world from where it's going to a better world.
Okay,
are you taking over those steps yourself right now? Or?
Absolutely. I've been doing this for a long time. I run probably the largest and most effective private intelligence organization in the world. I have millions of people all over the world that I've woken up and are doing their own research and are helping change things for the better.
A caller phoned in off the air and asked if you know anything about the Rael alien, R-H-E-L alien people.
Yeah, I know all about them.
Well, they just wondered what you thought of them.
I think it's the biggest bunch of bullshit I've ever heard in my life.
And what do they say? Because I'm not familiar with them.
Very simple. They're preaching Marxism.
Oh, and Marxism
one
is
world
bad.
Totalitarian socialist government. There's a vein running through every one of these people who claim that they have contact and are getting messages from extraterrestrials, including Billy Meyer, including the Rael group, including all of these people, the channelers, everything.
So
if you get at the major theme of what they're saying, it is socialism, Marxism, the elimination of private property, the bringing into the world of the communist dream.
Okay, well, yeah. Okay, that's your opinion, I guess. I'm not sure.
No, it's not opinion, it's actual fact.
Okay, well, okay. Well, I guess the people at CITR, other people listening might disagree with that. But anyways, moving away from that...
Well, wait a minute. Let's not move away from it. The fact that you're so eager to move away from it makes me eager to stay with it for just a few more minutes. Look at the document known as the Tenets of Communism that Marx wrote. Okay? It spells out in steps, step by step, what the doctrine of international socialism is.
Okay, how is communism...
Compare those steps, what all these people are preaching, you'll find that there is no difference whatsoever. They're exactly the same. So it's not a theory. I'm not making this up. It's fact.
Okay, what's the difference between Freemasonry or the Illuminati and... Isn't there a big difference between Illuminati and communism?
They're all the same. Communism came from the Illuminati.
But one is the controller.
Oh, okay, so that's the communism came from the Illuminati. Okay, that's what I wanted to know. Chapman, are you finished with your question?
I'm just going to hit him with one more question. Are all chapters of Freemasonry involved in this? It would seem that, to me, there would be a hierarchy of the
chapters. Absolutely. That's how they control stupid people. Most Freemasons are very stupid, and they are the greatest group of followers in the world.
So my friend's dad is a
white
Freemason.
That's correct.
Well, we're going to try to do that, but I'm getting a lot of resistance from people who now say he's not only Hispanic, and he not only doesn't look too nice on TV, but he's too old. So my question to people is, well, if the only honest man in Congress is not worth running for president in the next election, then what the hell are you people all about? I mean, why am I trying to save you when you're just that lost? I mean, you want to go after Ross Perot, who's in the pocket of the Rockefellers. They made him, they created him, and all he's doing is working for their interests. He's a billionaire. He doesn't give a damn about the guy that makes $5 an hour, and never will.
Okay. Actually, he was involved with IBM, and I got sucked into going to
okay, that's cool, but not
getting... broke my dad's wallet, and I've been pissed at the guy ever since.
We had a caller exploding off the air, and she asked, on the back of the American dollar bill, there's a pyramid.
Yes.
And the pyramid, and in Latin, it's written New World Order. Does that have anything to do with it?
Absolutely. The United States of America was founded by Freemasons, members of the Illuminati, for one purpose and one purpose only. It was an experiment in government to see if man could really rule himself or if he would have to be brought under control of those who can rule, and in the process, topple the kings and queens of Europe off their thrones. Well, the experiment was successful in that it did topple the kings and queens off their thrones, but it has not been successful because man has abdicated his responsibility to rule himself, and the New World Order is going to put him in chains again.
And there anything, Mr. Cooper, have there any been, with this kind of stuff you're talking about and the kind of people you're talking about, have there any been any threats on your life or even worried about your own personal security?
I've been threatened, I've been attacked, all kinds of things have happened to us, but that's not important to anybody out there. Anytime anyone stands up and fights for what is right, they're going to come under attack. And why would anybody care when they don't care about sending people to die in Iraq or Kuwait? I mean, nobody asked those guys that question.
Okay.
Here I am in my country really fighting for freedom, and everybody, the first thing they ask me, aren't you scared? And my question is, why don't you ask those guys that you're sending to die in the desert in the Middle East for something that has nothing to do with our freedom? Why aren't you asking them if they're scared?
These private armies, though, have tried on a couple of different occasions, as mentioned in your book, that they tried to kill you on two separate occasions and came and visit you in the hospital and everything.
That's correct.
You were run off the road.
That's correct.
And one of them cost you your leg.
That's correct.
Well, thanks for speaking to us, William Cooper. Again, if you could give your address out and phone number, just the people that are listening that are interested.
Well, first I'd like to say this. Don't be too concerned about my health or what happens to me, because I really believe in what I'm doing, number one. And number two, I believe that any man or woman on the face of this earth who does not have principles that they're ready and willing to die for at any given moment, in my estimation, are already dead or of no use or consequence to anybody. If you guys like to call Stan, call 602-567-6109. That's 602-567-6109. Or you can write to Stan and ask for a packet of information at Post Office Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's P.O. Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. And I might add that you people in Canada, you've already lost your constitution, you've already lost your freedoms, you're already in the New World Order, and there's some really strange things going on up there that you better get a handle on real quick.
Thanks, Mr. Cooper. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
And keep on rocking in a free world.
Thank you, and God bless you and your listeners.
Okay. Do-do-do-do.
Do-do.
So that was William Cooper live on the phone, and me and Ron are paying for this, right, Ron?
Yeah.
So that was how long?
Pretty
like,
much. An hour? Well, it's supposed to be half an hour, and we pushed that for probably almost an hour, so...
And Ron, you're from the Rock and Roll Band Cats game. You were transformed.
And Active Glands.
And Active Glands. We played some Active Glands earlier on in the show here today. There's one last thing that you want to say about William Cooper. I understand it a bit better. What about you, A.O.? Do you understand that? It's different from what he said the first time, wasn't it?
A slightly different impression. He was a little bit more clear. I was pleased to hear him.
Remember the first time when we saw that, when he gave that document, it said like all these aliens were coming down and Kennedy was killed by the driver and all this stuff. Was like, geez, he believes in aliens, but now he's saying, no, aliens don't exist. We just have the technology and it was developed by Hitler. And it's a hoax in order to get everybody in the world scared because the Illuminati are going to take over. Did you understand that?
I understand what he was saying. But from the original secret government document.
But why did he put out that document, I'm wondering?
I don't know. I guess his point to me was just that he was saying, well, this is what I saw. It's not necessarily
true.
Yeah,
this is what I saw, and then he followed it up.
I don't believe him actually saying that in the secret government file. Maybe he did. It's been a while since I've read it.
Some of that communism, like, I mean, come on, Ron, you being from the punk rock Active Glands, who for years sung about, you know, perhaps to praise some socialist values in your songs, have you become a, you know, I mean, are you like a born-again Christian commie? No, no, what again, anti-communist, anti-socialist now?
Not yet. Actually, what I've begun to do
is,
since I became I'm not an agent of William Cooper by any stretch of the imagination, I'm just really interested in what he has to say. And some of the things that I have seen on his video cassettes and what I have read in his book, which is entitled Behold a Pale Horse, and which I think any breathing, thinking human being should order this book from Stan, because I don't want to have to come in here and sit here and tell you about it. I want everybody out there to read this and make up your own minds, and then you won't have to listen to me, and you won't have to listen to all the mindless blabber that goes on. Get the book.
Get the videos.
He's got another 7-hour video cassette coming up. 7 hours! I mean, this guy is on 5 nights a week. He's been on for, like, months and months and years since, like, May 4th, 1990, he started going on the air, and that's putting on 3 hours, at least to 5 hours a week of information every week. And, I mean, how can we get any information out of this guy in 1 hour and have to yell at him from 3 different positions?
Okay.
It's stupid.
Okay, well, Ron, thanks for coming, anyways.
Oh, that's okay. I need a beer.
Okay, well, just a second, Ron. I'm saying with socialism, has your views changed on socialism?
I like my welfare check.
Also, that's good. Thank you very much, Ron. 1998, he says that's going to be the date, right?
Brilliant.
Right?
1998 has several... Okay, first of all, in the book Holy Blood, Holy Grail by Bajon Lee and Lincoln, there's a list of the nationaires of the pre-after sun, and the nationaires are the leaders all through the ages. And there was a leader by the name of Blanche Devereux who ruled from 1366 until 1398.
Now what a name of Golden Girls.
Coincidentally, I saw a video by... it was a Church of the Subgenius video, which is, you know, pretty craziness. Don't do nothing. Don't support your state in any way. And they said that there would be an alien return to the planet Earth on July 5th, 1998.
That's my birthday!
Well, we knew all along, Nardwuar. I mean,
really? That's no joke, July 5th?
You're part of the conspiracy as well, man. I could tell all along, personally.
Right. We all knew.
Okay, in 1998, and Cooper's basically saying, to sum up, that the aliens are going to invade in 1998, but it's not aliens, it's really the U.S. guys
in
the airplane.
Not just
in
the U.S. guys. No, not just U.S.
International.
Private armies funded by the worldwide Illuminati
conspiracy. What's this kryptonite 27 thing, the laptops that you were talking about, something about how Jupiter is going to blow up and screw us all.
Okay, the lowdown on that.
So from the UFOs attacking,
okay.
Jupiter is going to blow up to screw us even more, to scare us so we fall for these Illuminati.
I've actually attempted to back up his statement on that. I went to the Vancouver Planetarium.
What did he say?
I spoke, okay, first of all, what Cooper says in his book is that
The Project Galileo, which is a space probe that has been launched in 1989, is on its way to Jupiter, and it will orbit the planet Jupiter, and it will drop a little probe into the atmosphere of the planet Jupiter. The probe will be activated for 42 minutes, and what it will do is it will send back a continuous blur of information that will be bounced off the orbiting satellite and sent back to Earth. There has been documentation which states that aboard the orbiting spacecraft there is 49.7 pounds of plutonium, which as the orbit of the satellite decays, it will deliver this payload into the gravitational field of the planet Jupiter, and the gravity itself will act on the payload exactly as an implosion detonator acts on a nuclear warhead, and it will ignite the planet Jupiter into a star which has already been called Lucifer. Now, get a piece of paper and write down the word Jupiter in the English language, and right underneath it, write down Lucifer, and they match up exactly. However, David Dodge at the Vancouver Planetarium...
Who's that again?
David Dodge.
Who's that name again?
Mr. David Dodge. Professor David Dodge. I went there and I tried to find the three stars, the ancient Sumerian cuneiform that George Michinowski wrote about, that a star would reappear 6,000 years after it had disappeared in the heavens between Zeta Puppis, Gamma Valorum, and Lambda Valorum. We were unable to locate two of those stars, and he came to the conclusion that it's a ridiculous thing, and the fact is it won't happen because, at the very least, the explosion is too damn big, and it will blow itself out. However, what we have to remember is that planet Jupiter has a gaseous makeup of hydrogen and helium, and anybody out there who's ever seen a film footage of the Hindenburg knows very well what can happen to helium.
And you know what's really fun? You know,
that's hydrogen,
actually.
It's hydrogen because...
Okay, you got it right, man. What's one of the two?
Okay, and it's really scary now, Ron.
It's number one and number two on the periodic.
After having William Cooper in here to answer all these questions for people, William Cooper's show has been jammed. People haven't been able to get the information here yet. Even on this show right now, the phone line is jammed. 2487-822-487 is jammed. Somebody is jamming the phone right now to stop callers from coming through and asking questions. No, are you witnessing that?
Absolutely. Look at all those lights.
Look, they're getting jammed by Illuminati in this university and in this station.
It's almost like an alien's doing it or something.
I think it's very important to recognize the fact that, I personally haven't made up my mind on Cooper, and I think a lot of the stuff he says is a little...
You haven't read the book, have you?
I wouldn't say... it's somewhat dangerous. The fact that he goes on at great length to a lot of anti-Masonic stuff that's been going on for so long now that frankly I'm sort of skeptical of a lot of it. Hitler rounded up Freemasons and Jews and homosexuals and sort of rounded them up in the same bunch, and it's somewhat distressing to hear. I haven't made up my mind on what he's had to say, but I think some of it is a little questionable.
Okay, he is not anti-Mason. What he says is the fact that the Illuminatis, which is the elitist, the upper echelons of the Freemasonry religion, are going to have to, what he says is, depopulate the planet by as many as 2 billion people by the turn of this century. And Mr. Cooper says, without a doubt, that it's not going to be just Jews or blacks, and it's not just going to be because people die of AIDS, but Masons are going to die as well, because they are being used in order to get the word out there and provide support for the elitists, and they are not being given all the facts or all the secrets. They're not being taught all the handshakes.
Okay, well, thank you all for coming in, A.O. Chapman.
Thanks.
And you, Ron. Ron is also in Catskill. And sorry, callers, we're going to take some phone calls. You can ask Ron, who's in Catskill, as well as knowing about Cooper. He's in Catskill. But the phone line is still jammed. Seriously, it's jammed. What is going on with Catskill, Ron? Like, you recorded some stuff at What Speeches, your band. We're going to play a song by you guys, too.
Drummer's picking bananas, and there's...
Bassist playing brand new unit?
Yeah, bassist is in brand new unit, and the guitarist is up to something that I'm not going to mention.
And I will say, the first time I saw Catskill, I was scared.
Before anything else happens here, is I want to thank Mike B. for helping me research all this.
But the Cats game, the first time I saw you, I was scared. You had, like, things over your face, and you were hardcore punk rock.
We were.
You were? What happened? You went down to West Beach Recorders and recorded with Brett Religion and it all changed? Come on, tell me it's not true.
Somebody went bananas.
And what's the song right now here? We're coming out.
I started playing hockey again, actually.
So we can see you in action Sunday night?
Yeah, Sunday night at Britannia, actually. I'm playing there Sunday night.
What time?
I think it's 10:30.
What number are you?
I don't wear a number.
Oh, well, how can we recognize you? Are you the one yelling, Illuminati?
Well, that and stick work.
Isn't like when, like, in the, do you ever have, like, good luck at, like, the, at, like, 6, like, 13, sickle?
Jammed.
It's still jammed. And coming up, what is the song, Ron of Cat's Game?
I don't know which tape.
No, it's this one. Is it this tape?
That one?
Yeah.
To
end the interview.
The truth about the Pope to end the interview. Okay, well, the Pope. Pope John Paul II. Oh, this is so good. He was a chemist for IG Farben Chemical Company in 1936, and he made poison gas, Cyclone B, Malathion, and cyanide that were used in Auschwitz to murder Jews. He made the gas. He knew where it was going. He escaped to the church in 1958 and became the youngest bishop, and my mother happens to be quite a Catholic, so I'm a little annoyed at this, and so I wrote a song called Barbecued Pope. It's about Nostradamus' prophecies.
And this is Cat's Game, live on CITR. Thank you for coming in, Ron. Anyone else would like to add? Are you mad?
Kiss me, Nardwar.
Are you mad? Are you mad?
Not enough tongue.
Are you mad?
Absolutely.
Okay, you got the information across? AO, you satisfied?
Yes, thanks, sir, for having me on.
Okay, sure. So this is Cat's Game, Burn the Pope?
Barbecue Pope.
Listening to CITR Radio, FM 102, Cable 102, Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. And the Nardwar to Human Serviette Radio Show. And who do we have in the studio today?
Ron Moreau, singer from Cat's Game, Active Glands, and resident lunatic, I guess.
And Ron, who have you brought along with you on the phone here today?
We are talking to Milton William Cooper. He's at home there in the United States of America. He's a, I don't know, conspiracy theorist. He's on the air 5 nights a week on WWCR Worldwide Christian Radio, shortwave 7.435 kilohertz. From 9 until 10 p.m. Pacific time, and I don't know, I went out and bought a shortwave radio just to listen to him, and as it turns out, he is being jammed at certain times, and I'm annoyed, so now we have him on the air for my own personal revenge.
So, Bill, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
So, who are you, first off, for the listeners out there in Radio Land?
Well, just an ordinary average guy like everybody else, but many years ago, I spent some time in the service of my country and was trained and indoctrinated into the Office of Naval Intelligence, where I spent several years as an intelligence operative. And there I saw an awful lot of documentation that just told me that the world is not what the average person thinks it is. In fact, everybody out there is living in fantasy land and are very seldom ever told the real truth behind the scenes. And I decided I didn't want anything to do with that kind of deception, so I left the service about 5 years before I could have retired very comfortably upon everybody's tax dollars. And I've been researching the meaning of all of the documentation that I saw and everything that I learned while I was in naval intelligence for the last 20-some-odd years, and the results are just absolutely amazing.
One of the results that you've been studying is the Kennedy assassination.
That's correct.
You believe, or you have proof, that the driver of the limousine that Kennedy was in killed Kennedy, in fact.
No. What I saw is in documentation, a top-secret document under an operation called Operation Majority, that the driver had killed President Kennedy, and that the act was plainly visible in a film that was withheld from the public. It described the weapon that was used, and the reason for his brain disappearing was to prevent an autopsy from discovering the real type of projectile and weapon that was used, which was a gas-operated or gas-powered, electronically operated assassination pistol developed by the Central Intelligence Agency, which actually fired an exploding pellet containing shellfish toxin. I mean, nobody could survive a hit like that. It was absolutely impossible that he could have lived, no matter where he was hit in the body with that kind of a weapon.
You learned this while studying this. You were working for the military at the time?
Yes, I was working for the Office of Naval Intelligence, and I discovered that operatives of the Office of Naval Intelligence actually participated in the assassination.
And this is not the Zapruder film that you saw this on?
No, this was on hard documentation, paper copy. Then I began looking for a film that would show it, because the documentation said that it was plainly visible in a film withheld from the public. Well, it was in 1972 that I saw this documentation. It wasn't until 1988 that I was able to see a copy of the Zapruder film that appeared to show William Greer turning around and shooting the president, William Greer being the driver of the car, the Secret Service agent that the documents claimed had done it.
Okay, did you originally get that film from Lars Hansen?
No, I originally got the film from John Lear, who stated that he had obtained it from a CIA operative who was a friend of his. Well, that CIA operative who was a friend of his turned out to be Lars Hansen.
How about in a typical Zapruder film that people know? Can you actually see it happening? You know, they would play it often on the anniversary of the assassination of JFK. You're saying if you look closely at the driver, you can see him turning around and killing Kennedy.
Well, that's what it appears to be. That's what it appears to see. What you see in that film confirms what I saw in documentation, if what we're seeing in the film is correct. We have since obtained a first-generation copy of the original Zapruder film from a member of my intelligence organization, from the government of the United States, and we put that on the computer, and we've seen that they have literally scraped the emulsion right off of the film. So what appears to be William Greer turning around and shooting the president is actually, there's nothing there on the film when you look at it on a computer. So what they've either done is they've planted documents stating that William Greer killed the president and shown them to many people, not only me. I'm not the only one who saw those documents while in the service of my country. And one other person who was never in the military, Linda Moulton Howe, was shown the same documents in the Air Force Office of Special Investigation headquarters at Kirtland Air Force Base by Sergeant Richard Doty. Stated the exact same thing, and the documents were from the same Operation Majority. So either it's true and they've scraped the emulsion off the film so that you cannot see anything there, but you can tell that it's not a play of light, it's not reflection, they're hiding something, or they've either scraped the emulsion off the film to create something in our conscious that actually didn't happen. We're not exactly sure what. But one thing it proves beyond any shadow of any doubt whatsoever that they've never been able to prove conclusively before is that it definitely was a conspiracy, because whoever doctored the film was a part of the assassination group and they're trying to hide something or lead the public astray.
Now, Mr. Cooper, you have a degree in photography, don't you?
Yes, I did.
From where?
From Long Beach.
Long Beach.
So, Greer, as we're talking here to William Cooper. Where are you right now?
I'm in Arizona. I live in Arizona.
Somewhere in Arizona. And we also have here Ron from the local band Cats Game. And you're on the Nonviolent Human Serviette Show. You mentioned that the driver, Greer, turned around and killed Kennedy. Do you believe there are any other shots fired? Like, was he working in tandem with people?
Well, I think there were several shots fired. That's obvious. But I believe that most of the shots were fired from the front, not from the rear. No shots were fired from the sixth floor of the depository building. Lee Harvey Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination, except that he was a patsy, in fact. And we have a photograph of him actually standing in the doorway of the ground floor of the book depository building, watching the motorcade as it passes by. So we can prove conclusively that Lee Harvey Oswald was not even inside the building. In fact, he was in the doorway watching the motorcade pass by when the president was assassinated.
What happened to the driver of the Kennedy limousine?
We have no idea. We found documentation that said that he died in 1985. If you know anything about the intelligence community, that does not mean that he's dead.
How about other figures that were on the scene at the time, like that umbrella man? If you look at the Kennedy assassination, there's a guy holding an umbrella, and it was like a really nice day in Dallas. What was he doing with an umbrella?
Well, we believe that was the signal. See, once a shot is fired and the president is hit, it must go through to its conclusion. So the first shot, wherever it came from, and it had to come from the front because it hit him in the throat and there was no exit wound, that shot hit the president. The man standing there on the curb saw that, opened the umbrella. That signaled everyone who was involved in the assassination that the president had been hit. That meant that no matter what happened, he could not be allowed to escape alive. You see, because if he had escaped alive and lived, then he could have spent the rest of his administration hunting those people down and hanging them by the neck until dead.
So they were hoping to kill him with the shots that were fired safe from the grassy knoll, but they didn't, so the driver had to finish him off.
Well, that's exactly what it looks like.
And how about Mrs. Kennedy? And she hasn't come forward because she's just afraid?
She never could come forward, number one. At the time, the people who were involved in the assassination of her husband were surrounding her children. Her children were in their care, and were in their care for many years thereafter. So,
did the Kennedy family receive kickbacks for the loss of their son? Or?
We have traced payments to the Kennedy family made by an officer from the Coast Guard station at Peanut Island across the property boundary under the Kennedy property. Suitcases of money were delivered to the Kennedy family for approximately 6 years following the assassination. So we believe that the Kennedy family were convinced that whatever reason their son was assassinated was in the best interest of the country, and were paid off to keep their mouth shut.
Yeah, so whatever is going on here is obviously worth the loss of a son for money then.
Well,
as far as they're concerned.
Apparently they had their price, and that price was satisfied. Let's put it that way.
Have you heard of Dave Emery at all before from Radio Free America?
No, I don't know anything
about Valentine, obviously.
No.
Well, Dave Emery broadcasts every night on CITR from 10 to 12 on Sunday nights. He's also on KFGC, Los Altos Hills, Berkeley. And he believes in a lot of stuff, a lot of the white Russians that were in Dallas at the time, like George DeMora showed.
Forget all that stuff.
You don't believe that? You don't believe anything with Dave
Emery? Forget all that stuff. If you've never been to Dealey Plaza, take a trip. John F. Kennedy was killed by the secret society, specifically the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry.
So now it's the perfect time for you to go into the Atlanta lecture video that you've just finished.
This is a second wrong. We're not finished yet. Just a second here. Let's just get back to this for a second. This is the Kennedy assassination. So you're saying Radio Free America, Dave Emery, he says a lot of stuff is based around the Galen organization. Are you familiar with the Galen organization?
Forget that.
Stop laughing,
it.
Ron. This is important.
Let me tell you something. Stop looking at the exoteric or what people are throwing out for you as bait and start looking at the esoteric, the real occult meanings of everything surrounding this assassination. Kennedy was assassinated in Dealey Plaza, which is in the shape of a truncated triangle. In other words, the top has no capstone. There is an eye in that triangle. It's the underpass under the railroad overpass. Okay? This is a well-known occult symbol for the Illuminati, or those who are illumined, or the guardians of the secrets of the ages. Dealey Plaza also has the four quarters of a Celtic or Druid temple of the sun in Dealey Plaza. It is an exact duplicate, although cut in four quarters, of the temple of the sun, which is the outer courtyard of the Vatican. There is also an obelisk in Dealey Plaza, cut into 14 sections, which is the symbol of the phallus of Osiris, the lost word of Freemasonry, the generative force, the light, Lucifer, which is the god of this secret society.
Okay, I mentioned Dave Emery earlier, and we're talking here to William Cooper. William, are you the only one, Bill, preaching these ideals?
Preaching anything. I'm just telling people to open their eyes and look at what's there. Kennedy was assassinated on the 33rd parallel, the highest degree, the meritorious degree of the secret societies. He was assassinated on November the 22nd. You add November the 11th month with 22, you get 33 again. It also happens to be the anniversary date of the Pope's papal bull condemning the Knights Templar to torture by the Dominican monks under the Inquisition. You subtract the year 1307 when that papal bull was issued from 1963, and you get 666. Kennedy was shot in the head, the throat, and the back, the exact same wound suffered by Hiram Abiff in the Masonic initiation, which they have sworn to revenge.
How about the signing of the Declaration of Independence of the United States on July 4th, 1776? That all traces in there as well.
That all goes in there.
How about the Lincoln assassination? Are there any links to that? Are you into that?
Lincoln's been dead for a lot of years. The people who assassinated him are dead. Anybody that's following that around is wasting their time. We need to deal with today, not 100 years ago.
Okay, so is there anybody else that believes these things that you do? Are you the first one to bring this out?
I'm the first one who's ever looked at it. Everybody else is running around believing all these disinformation peddlers.
Who are they? Who are the disinformation peddlers?
They're all these people who write a new book every year with new evidence, with new this, with new that, all pointing in different directions, and one says it's the Mafia, and the other says it's the Galen Organization, the other blames it on the CIA. The truth is, it's members of all of those who belong to the secret societies.
What, how long have you been researching this?
God, for...
20 years?
About
20 years, huh?
What other media exposure have you gotten?
Well, not very much, simply because people who play around with this and really try to get it out in front of the public eye usually end up dead somewhere.
You did get a play on Flipside magazine, right?
Yes.
How much feedback from that?
Yeah, I got quite a bit of feedback. I was amazed that so many young people who usually aren't concerned about anything except getting in somebody's pants and getting high were really interested in what's going on and where their country is heading, and I was surprised by that because I didn't think that that many young people were, and that pleased me quite a bit.
How about hard copy? Haven't been on any of those or any other future things coming up?
Hard copy was going to put on the Kennedy information, and 1 hour before we were to go on the air, they got a phone call from a top executive in NBC and told him if they put me on the air, they'd all be fired. So that was the end of that.
How can a secret be kept so long? I mean, there has to be some botch-ups along the way.
It's pretty easy when you think of who owns NBC in the first place. And
well,
they're supposedly building UFOs.
You're looking at it in the wrong way, guys. Normally, secrets can't be kept this long, and even though that they have been kept, there have still been leaks. And there always will be leaks when people are involved with anything.
And I guess you're a leak.
That's correct. But what you're looking at is not just a bunch of guys that decided to assassinate the president. You're looking at an ancient organization that goes back in history for some 6,000 years, which has blood oaths, which is, in fact, a religion, and everybody who belongs in it believes wholeheartedly and completely in what they're doing, and that's the real reason why the secret can be kept. They're promoting a religion with blood oaths that they'll be murdered if they ever reveal the secrets.
How about a Canadian link? Are there any Canadian links to the secret?
Absolutely. Just walk around in your own town, and pretty soon you're going to bump up against a temple without any windows that says the Masonic Lodge, Masonic Temple, Freemason Umpty-Ump, whatever.
What, the one on Agnes Street, New Westminster there.
How about Brian Mulroney, our Prime Minister? Is he aware?
Absolutely.
And he just quit, after he signed NAFTA, and that essentially, created Kingdom One of the New World Order, and then he got the hell out, just after Joe Clark did, you know?
Sure, so a new guy can come in and say, well, it's not my fault, you know, and continue on and do his part.
And actually, on Canada AM last week, on Wednesday morning, he actually said that he was going to move back to Montreal to pursue religious beliefs.
That's exactly right.
So what should people do with these Islamic halls? Should they bomb them, Bill?
No, I don't advocate violence. I advocate dealing everything within the law. But you have to realize you can put a lot of social pressure on these people. You can just socially ban them from everything in the community. Don't talk to them. If they come in your store, don't serve them.
It's very easy.
Don't invite them to parties. Don't talk to them. Just shun them.
Do you have to shake their hand and have them pressing on your second knuckle and tickling your palm to find out who they are? Or?
No, all you got to do is go down to the Masonic Temple when they have their meetings and see who goes in and out.
Take a video camera?
Yeah, take a video camera. Play it on local access TV and expose who these creep destroyers are, because they're destroying society.
Ron, this is not a comedy show. This is serious. And we do have a question from another station member here, Bill, to pose towards you. And A.O. Chapman joins us now. A.O.?
Hello. I have a few questions, Bill.
Sure.
And I'd like to ask, first of all, if you've read the book, The Holy Blood and the Holy Grail.
Yes, I have.
What is
that book, first, A.L.?
It's a book written, I guess, about 3 or 4 years ago now. And it, among other things, talks about, I'm trying to encapsulate it.
It opens up part of the picture. What it's talking about is a portion of the reason for the secret society's existence today. That is to guard the bloodline of those who supposedly, with the secret societies believe, have the divine right to rule. And they are preparing in secret one of these members of that family to be the charismatic political and religious leader of the world in the New World Order.
So you feel that book was pretty much on the line.
Made a lot of mistakes, and they didn't carry it to its fulfillment. They left a lot of... of guesswork up to the reader, but they gave the reader enough clues that if they wanted to do their own research, they could come up with the answers themselves anyway. The problem is most people are so damn lazy, they'll never get off their butt and look up anything.
Right. Okay, one thing we haven't really got into that much today, I guess, is some of your stuff that you've written about MJ-12. And I'd like to ask, the first stuff I ever read of, that came across from you was...
What is MJ-12? Is that UFOs?
That is regarding the UFOs. The first stuff I ever came across of yours was something called The Secret Government,
uh-huh.
That I think is dated from 1989.
Yeah, A.O. Chapman, in the other room here, Bill, he gave me a Xerox photocopy manuscript of yours. It was, like, really cryptic. It was, like, passed around. People were, like, showing it to each other and creating all this fur. But then I saw you in Slipfly, and I found out you really were a real guy.
Oh, yeah?
I'm curious to know, in one excerpt from that, I remember reading about you speak of General Forrestal being, I guess, murdered.
Well, he wasn't a general, he was Secretary of Defense, and he was murdered, there's no doubt about that. He was murdered by...
They threw him out a window and hung him by a bed sheet.
Yeah.
Right.
And later on, they changed it to say that his bathrobe belt was wrapped around his neck, but that was all made to look like he had committed suicide.
Right. Now, one thing that you, I remember stated in the secret government paper that I read, was that the very last page, I believe, stated some idea of directions from you to keep aware of this stuff, but I'm curious to know, I mean, to get into it now, the whole ramifications of what's stated in that essay. Perhaps is the wrong thing to do right now, but I'm curious to know what actual
good phrasing, Ayo.
What actual things do you recommend to the average person to not only just keep aware but to protect oneself? Because I mean, a lot of this stuff is as strange as it sounds.
Well, number one, they have to understand that what's happening in the world today is not the result of any accident. It's the result of a long range plan that is coming into fruition now to break down the sovereignty of all nations, destroy all existing religions, and create a one-world government, a one-world religion, which will be totalitarian and socialist in nature. And with these,
what's wrong with socialism?
With these free trade agreements, they're in the process of destroying the middle class. What's wrong with socialism?
Yeah.
Socialism is for babies.
Okay.
Socialism is for people who cannot stand up and be responsible for their own actions, who cannot find their own job, who cannot feed themselves, who do not know how to...
Okay, what are you? What are you, Bill? Are you a Democrat or are you an anti-fascist?
Well, where they decide exactly what they want the goal to be, then they create two opposing sides, the clash of which will bring about the goal that they wanted, and the people will look at it as if it appeared by magic or by accident or that it was their own idea, so they are more readily accept it. This is not a theory. If you study history and really get in and study these organizations, you begin to see that it's fact.
Okay.
And can be documented.
Okay, Bill, I guess we're winding down the time here now. We're speaking here to Bill Cooper, and what would you classify yourself as, just in a couple words or less?
Well, I don't know what you mean by that.
Like, who are you? Like, if somebody said, I was listening to CITR and I heard Bill Cooper, he's,
I'm an average, ordinary person, just like anybody else, not any smarter, not any dumber, who's really seriously concerned about the future of our freedom.
And we also have in the studio here Ron from Cats Game, who is a devout follower of William Cooper, and A.O. Chapman, who contributed some stuff. I'd like to move just a bit to some of the... Okay. I'd like to get now to some of the UFO stuff here. Well, not UFO, but is it my understanding, from what I've understood from seeing your videotapes, is it true that the U.S. Army possesses spaceships and will eventually fake an alien invasion in 1998 in which will unite the world under the leadership of Freemasons?
That's one of the scenarios.
Or the fact is that they could conceivably begin to attack us with this sort of super secret technology about a year before this star is supposed to reappear in the heavens. Therefore, everybody would be in such a state of panic that the Illuminatis could say that, oh, well, hey, if you guys are all panicking, look, here's our star. We said it would reappear. There it is. We are right. You are wrong, and we're taking over.
So how did the U.S. Army, who seems to be bungling a lot of stuff, how did they get a hold of alien craft, and how long have they had contact with them?
Well, first place, it's not the U.S. Army. It's secret agencies within the United States government that are under control of the secret societies. These things are being flown at a super secret test site called Groom Dry Lake or Area 51 in the state of Nevada. We have them on videotape, extensive footage, both at night and daylight. They are what people normally call UFOs, flying saucers, some of them are circular shaped, that are owned and operated by humans. They're either remote controlled or have human pilots. We're not exactly sure which. But they're not extraterrestrial at all. They're the results of a secret technology that were originally developed by the Germans during World War II, but not perfected to the state of being used as a weapons platform.
How did we get a hold of the technology? Like, did we meet aliens?
No, we took it from the Germans.
We took it from the Germans. Okay, how did the aliens, have anybody in the U.S. government ever met any aliens?
We don't know if there are any aliens at all.
But wasn't there, okay, an alien craft that crashed that you refer back to?
These aliens could have been created in something like a cryogenics lab in the future.
Did I answer the question you're wrong? Okay.
Sorry, John.
Oh, thanks very much. Oh, so Bill, where the alien craft ever crashed, landed?
We don't know. We know that the government has set up a scenario where there is evidence that seems to point that something crashed, which has been interpreted as an extraterrestrial craft with dead extraterrestrial bodies. But these could have been monkeys with their ears and tail cut off and surgical intervention done to their eyes, and who knows what it was.
Okay, how did the Germans get this technology then?
They developed it with their science.
So you're saying, well, just moving something a bit closer to home here,
Let me put it this way for you, so that you'll understand it a little better. Governments cannot exist unless the people feel threatened. The primary job of a government is to give the people a modicum of safety. The United States government was formed by a union of the states for their mutual benefit and protection. Okay? Now, to have a one-world government and tear down all the national boundaries, you have to instill the people of the world with enough fear that they're willing to give up what they used to be loyal to and join with something that's new that they don't know what it's going to be. What better way to do that than if the Earth were attacked or invaded by some other species from some other planet, whether real or imagined?
Okay, what about abductions? Here on the North Shore, well, in Vancouver, B.C., there's something for the North Shore News here, Sunday, February 23rd, 1993. It says, close encounters of the North Shore kind, 9 sightings in the past year prompt UFO researchers to look for alien hotspots. And in it, it talks about abductions and alarm sensors going off and dogs hearing whining and people getting radiated.
You got to be careful now. Dogs can't talk, so nobody knows what dogs hear, number one. Number two, most so-called ufologists or UFO researchers are blithering idiots and wouldn't know how to do any research if you sat down and taught them for a year. And number three, if you start looking into the actual research and development of brainwashing and mind control techniques by the United States, Great Britain, Canada, the Soviet Union, and others, and if you'll look at the mind control experiments and the actual lobotomies that were performed on people in hospitals in Canada, you'll see that this alien abduction thing is probably the most sophisticated and successful mind control operation ever conducted in the history of the world, and it's designed to make us believe that we're being threatened by some other species from some other planet so that they can have their one world government.
But didn't you say in one of your papers that there was an agreement that aliens were allowed to pluck people from Earth?
Nope. You see, this is what happens. People don't read what I write. What I said was, this is what I saw in documents when I was in Naval Intelligence.
So you're saying there are no UFOs out there, probably?
No, that's not what I said. UFOs are real. I can prove that at least some of them are owned and operated by humans here on this Earth.
Okay, they're humans, but there's no alien ones.
We don't know.
So you don't know?
I don't know if aliens exist or not, but I will tell you this. In 1917, John Dewey said this in 1917. What better way to unite all humanity in a one-world government than if we were attacked by some other species from some other planet?
Wasn't E.T. based on a true story? E.T.?
If what I saw in government documents when I was in Naval Intelligence is true, then yes. If not, it's just another part of the conditioning of our collective consciousness to accept the reality of something that doesn't exist.
And we've been on the moon since 1948 as well.
Yeah, what I'm trying to tell you is nobody really knows, but whatever the truth about UFOs is, it's being used to make us give up our freedoms and join in a one-world totalitarian socialist state, and that's what we better be careful of.
How about the Hubble telescope? Does that play into this at all?
I have no idea. All I know is what they said about it not being tested before it was launched is a lie. The government never does anything without testing every step thoroughly 6 or 8 times.
Just one question.
Yeah, Mr. Cooper, I'm call reading in the secret document, in the secret government document that I read of yours. It's been a while since I read this, so maybe you can find it.
Maybe an alien krill, right?
Exactly. And you said you saw photographs of that alien. Are you tracking those photographs up with just... That may be part of the conspiracy as well, or?
It certainly could, because not too long ago, it appeared in the newspapers in the United States, and we verified it in research, that Walt Disney and the Walt Disney Studios were involved with projects with the intelligence community, and Walt Disney was a 33rd degree Freemason, and most of his executives and people who worked in his corporation were 33rd degree Freemasons also. We also found in 1958 and in other years where they had symposiums investigating with scientists present investigating the possibility of colonizing the moon and other planets that Walt Disney representatives were heavily in attendance.
And also I recall reading in the same document about the, I believe it was, you stated it as a holographic film of the crucifixion of Christ.
I stated that those documents said that existed, but I never saw it.
You never saw it, okay.
Okay, William Cooper here. Refer you back, we're speaking to William Cooper, just an average guy phoning somewhere from Austin, Texas.
Not average at all.
Not an average, Ron says. But according to this report about UFOs, I'm sorry to dwell on this again, but it says there are several different kinds of UFOs, it says in this article. They range from the bizarre religious people who are trying to put their point or view across to ex-CIA people. We're not fence-sitters, this guy says. Now, you mentioned you're religious before. Were they referring to you when they say they range from bizarre religious people who are trying to put their point of view across?
I can't speak for that author. I have no idea who it is, but I'm not a bizarre religious person.
This was the guy...
You haven't heard me preaching anything, have you?
No, I haven't. Well, maybe some interesting things. But this guy's Lorne Goldfather from the Texas-based Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence.
Never heard of him, never heard of his organization, and how can he have a center for the study of extraterrestrial intelligence when nobody even knows if such a thing exists?
Well, what did the music...
Just that fact alone makes him sound more like the blithering idiot than anybody else.
What type of music do you like, Bill?
I like all different kinds of music, and I play all different kinds of music on my radio show, all the way from rap to classical.
I heard Chuck Berry
songs. So people can tune into you if they want.
Oh, yeah.
Do you show, where is that on the dial?
First you have a shortwave radio, and you got to have a good antenna. The most important thing about listening to shortwave is the antenna, not really the set.
And a copper wire works best.
But they can tune in at 7435 megahertz. That's WWCR, and it's worldwide, 100,000 watts. My show is heard in every city and every continent of the world, and occasionally... they jam my program because the information that I'm putting out is really hurting a lot of their efforts.
Yeah, it seems like whenever you really begin to get to the heart of the matter, the program seems to leave the air completely.
Has anybody taken your call, aside from Ron here from Cats Game? Hi, Ron, how are you?
Not bad.
Ron, has anybody influential in the American government taken, or any officials, low-ranking ones, been converted from what you were saying and are working on stuff? Like, do you have any, like, Arsenio Hall, perhaps?
Arsenio Hall, are you serious? Get real. Arsenio Hall, if anybody's living in fantasy land, he is. He wouldn't know reality if it smacked him upside the head. He is a good entertainer, and I enjoy watching his show, but let's not get him confused with reality here.
Is there anybody that's come, anybody in the entertainment industry, or anybody that's come forward and agreeing with your stuff besides Ron from Cats Game?
Yeah, let's actually direct this towards, like, let's say Oliver Stone here now. I don't want to regress, but
did
you attempt to contact Oliver Stone before he went into pre-production for the movie JFK?
That's correct. Attempted over and over again, hundreds of times, to contact him. Not only myself, but intermediaries and other people. He absolutely refused to acknowledge our existence or even speak to us. And when you watch his film, you'll see that what he's doing is blaming everything on our government. What he's saying, in effect, is constitutional government doesn't work, and that's a lie, in order to get us to be dissatisfied so that we'll accept the New World Order when it comes.
So do you think that the name Oliver Stone is like a pseudonym, and that Stone has to do with the actual basic teachings of the Freemason religion, what you were talking about?
Absolutely, and he must be a member because he shows in his film that he knows who really killed Kennedy, And in the way that he does it, he's actually laughing at the rest of us.
Yeah.
When Garrison and Prouty are sitting on the park bench in Washington, D.C., and they're talking about why, and he says, that's the question, isn't it? Why?
So then
who had the power? Who had the opportunity? Who had this? Who had that? And then the camera moves back, and they become real tiny in the picture. In fact, you can barely see them. And there's one dominating scene. There's one dominating part of that picture, and that is the Washington Monument, which is the obelisk, the phallus, the lost word of Freemasonry, the law of
Luciferians. There is an obelisk in sort of the front garden of the Vatican, is there not?
There is an obelisk in the Temple of the Sun.
These are Masonic things, right? Well, that has to do with, Mr. Cooper, would you elaborate on what an obelisk is?
The obelisk is the symbol of the lost part of Osiris.
It's his penis, isn't it?
That's right. He was chopped into 14 pieces, flung about the land. Isis went to recover him, could find everything but the generative part, the phallus, the penis. It's the symbol of the lost word of Freemasonry.
So we're to believe that this thing swam across the Mediterranean by itself and came up out of the water at the Vatican or something. Okay, I just want to finish up on the UFO things here, Ron, for a second here, Ron from Cat's Game. Now, you were in Vietnam, weren't you? How come the United States government, the people in control didn't use any UFOs in Vietnam or in the Gulf War to wipe out?
There were a lot of UFO incidents involved in Vietnam, and I believe they were testing the military or weaponry capability of the craft. Vietnam had UFO incidents from the very southern tip to the northern tip all the time.
They were known as NVA helicopters?
Well, when they were discussed in official dispatches or messages, the code word for UFO activity was enemy helicopter activity.
Didn't any of them crash? Any enemy get a hold of them?
Not that I'm aware of.
How about that also, that troop motivating drug? Are there troop motivating drugs?
There are all kinds of drugs given to certain units depending upon what their mission is. Some drugs are just to keep them awake for long periods of time. Some are to give them an artificial form of energy so that they can travel long periods, long distances in short periods without collapse. Some are to give them a mental attitude so that they go into battle, they're not afraid. Drugs are used extensively to accomplish certain goals in the military and in the intelligence community. And will continue to be until the people get smart enough to put the lid on these creeps and stop them from all this stuff.
How about the RFK assassination? Sirhan Sirhan supposedly was hypno-programmed to kill Robert Kennedy. Are you into that at all?
Well, he was certainly hypno-programmed, but he didn't kill Robert Kennedy.
So there is
hypno-programmed. Killed by a close-range shot from within 1 or 2 inches behind his right ear, and the only one standing in that position was a security guard named Caesar, who has since disappeared.
And so people can't, but so Sirhan Sirhan, can people be hypno-programmed?
Absolutely. As I said before, if you begin to study the developments and operational programs of brainwashing and mind control, you'll find that what they can do is absolutely incredible, will blow your mind, and will teach you that right now the possibility of total control over every human being on the face of this earth for every 24 hours of their lives is a distinct possibility in the very near future.
Therefore, it is true then that, like, Mark Lapine, who committed the Montreal Massacre, who was on the drug Prozac, also the fellow who went into, James Huberty, who did the massacre at the McDonald's, they were all on Prozac, and all their drugs came supposedly from the same place, and that the doctor's name has never been released because... Well, for obvious reasons, right?
Sure, this is correct. And I was lecturing about this. I told people that this was going to happen long before it happened. I wrote it in my book that there would be mass murders committed by ex-mental patients who were on the drug Prozac. It's just another one of my predictions that came true, but nobody seems to be paying much attention.
How about the Bermuda Triangle? Are you into that at all?
No. Let me make one thing perfectly clear here. I'm not into mysterious things or witchcraft or disappearing ships or anything like that. My only purpose, and the only reason I even began to do any of this, is because I believe that sometime in the near future we're all in danger of losing the affluence that we worked hard for. We're in danger of losing our personal freedoms and becoming somebody's slave in the New World Order. And that's the only thing I care about, that's the only thing I'm fighting, and that's the only reason I'm doing any of this.
And people can actually go and search out and find CD's UFO bases that are controlled by elements of the American establishment.
Not just the American. You see, we believe that the first flying discs were actually perfected in a remote area of northwestern Canada.
So are there any, where can people find these?
Go research the AV Row Aviation Company.
And they can order, your videotape too. Maybe we should give your address right now, William Cooper, if you could. And on your videotapes, which I actually saw, you do actually go to great lengths in one of them to show about the Kennedy assassination and how the driver did turn around and shoot Kennedy. And another one goes into a lot of the UFOs and you actually going out there trying to find one of those UFO bases and you get close to it, but they thwart you away.
No, they didn't escort us away. And we did photograph the craft flying both at night and in the daylight. They did harass us. They threatened us. Did all kinds of things. But I'm not easily scared, and I know my rights, so they were not successful.
One foot on the wrong side of that line, though, and like you said, they could shoot you or they could charge you.
That's correct. They have the right, and they have been ordered to use a deadly force if need be if you step across the line.
Okay, briefly, I would like to put
my address on.
Just a second. It's a miracle. This gentleman is on the line here. What I would like to ask you is, on Project Red Light 2, you see that the spacecraft, they disappear from this time. Now, does that mean that they could possibly be carrying human beings either forward or backwards in time? And
that's exactly what it means.
And
that's true. It would explain a lot of mysterious things that have happened in the past.
Especially the Roswell crash, because in the future it might very well be possible to sort of create some type of alien appearing being and then go back to 1948 and drop it in the desert there so that somebody on secret sightings or something like that can say, oh yeah, 30 years ago I saw an alien being, when in fact nobody knows that it actually did come from a human-made laboratory somewhere in the future and was dropped back there in order to create sort of a beginning of the panic that might happen within the next 3 to 5 to 7 years.
That's a possibility. With time travel, it would then be feasible to re-engineer the past to create a new future.
Oh.
And that is mind-blowing. It is
It's really hard to understand.
Okay, now, first off, this is live. This is the Nardwuar Human Serviette Show here, live today, the 26th of February, 1993, and we're speaking to William Cooper. No, this isn't a tape, as one caller phoned in and asked if it was. It isn't a joke. This is serious. And if people are interested and want further information on William Cooper, I'd say, first off, if anybody reads Flipside Magazine, the music mag from L.A., which is really great and features articles by KRK as well, there's a big piece that William Cooper can to that for the past couple issues. You can check that out, or you can write to William Cooper. And Mr. Cooper, if you could explain what you have and your address and phone number and whatnot, please.
Well, it's best just to call or write and ask for an information packet, and we'll send you a list of everything that we have and what we're doing. You can call my representative. His name is Stan. He's really a great guy. His number is 602-567-6109. That's 602-567-6109, or you can write to Stan, STAN, Post Office Box 889, Camp Verde. That's spelled V as in Victor, ERDE, Spanish for green, Arizona, 86322. That's Stan, PO Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322, and just ask for a packet of information and Stan will send you one. If you want it real quick, give him a call. It'll be in the mail tomorrow.
Well, thank you very much for speaking with us, William Cooper. We're just wrapping down here, and it's really interesting about all this UFO stuff. To tell you the truth, when I first heard about what you're doing, I thought you were saying, aliens crashed, we stole their craft, and we have the technology, and people are allowed to be plucked from the earth. But as you've told me now, that's wrong, right? From what you did not mean that.
My paper, the initial press release that I did was called Operation Majority, and it was a list of things that I could remember seeing pertaining to UFOs in top secret documents while I was in naval intelligence. The second document that I released was called The Secret Government, which if what I had seen in those documents was true, and if what I'd been able to research was true, and that others had researched, and documents released under the FOIA were true, then it was, in fact, the history, as close as anybody's ever been able to write the history, of extraterrestrial visitation to this Earth. If not, it's what they want us to believe.
And at
the beginning of that, I had a hypothesis statement saying that this is a hypothesis based upon this, this, and this, which has been taken off. And at the end, I had five conclusions. Number five was the fact that this could be the greatest hoax in the history of the world, designed to create an alien threat that does not exist to bring about a one-world government, which has also been removed.
Where can people find these UFOs in Canada? They just have to go there and study or buy your video and find it? I mean, people want some proof. Where can they delve deeper besides from your stuff?
Get the video into
other stuff.
Right after World War II, A.V. Rowe built a veritable city in northwest Canada to work on top-secret aviation developments, one of which was the flying disc, which is called flying saucers or UFOs.
Which city?
Research A.V. Rowe. Find their secret test sites, and you'll be able to film these things flying in Canada just like I can film them flying here in the United States.
Yeah, actually, the flying disc, isn't it in the National, isn't it in the Smithsonian or one of the old, there's actually I saw a documentary on it, and they said it was a failed craft. Well, I guess according to you, it wasn't failed.
That was to convince the public that we humans don't have the technology necessary to build one of those things, which was a disinformation program called Project Snowbird.
Okay, who are the bad guys? Who are the bad guys just right off the bat? The Masons?
Well, nobody's really a bad guy. You got to understand that these guys aren't doing this because they're evil or they think that they're bad. They're doing it because they actually believe that it's the best for all humanity. But their assumption is wrong. Anything that has to be manipulated, anything that has to be brought about by lies and deceit is inherently wrong in its premise to begin with. So they're fooling themselves. They believe that the rest of us are so stupid that we're just like cattle, and that's what they call us, and that they're the only ones with truly mature minds, and that they've got to bring all the rest of us under total and complete control so that they can run the world the way they want to, and they actually believe that there's going to be a utopia because of what they bring about.
I saw a flowchart that you did, I'll tell you more specific, that like Barbara Walters was in on this, like who exactly is in on this? Who knows the secret?
Not all of these people know the secret.
But they're part of it.
But they're part of it, yes.
Okay. So who are some of them? I just want, like, for instance, like you said, you like Arsenio's show. Arsenio's show is probably produced by Columbia or whatever. And Columbia's, I mean, what are the actual specifics?
You're asking me for something that would take me a long, long time to tell you.
Any surprising ones?
It's been a fat half hour, I know.
Any surprising ones, Bill, that you could throw out there just for people in Canada? Like Safeway shopping malls, Woodward's?
Well, I don't have any idea what would surprise you, but I'll tell you this, that look for names and symbols. For instance, Mazda is the name of one of the ancient representations of the god of this religion. So when you look at corporations like Honeywell and you see that they have a European division named Lucifer and things like that, I mean, people out there cannot depend upon people like me or anyone else, and I always tell people this, that you cannot ever worship a leader. You cannot believe anything that anyone says, and everybody listening right now, and everybody in this world, in fact, if we're going to maintain our freedom, and if we're going to have a good future, everybody has to learn to do on their own individual initiative what I'm doing.
Famer said, food for thought, grounds for further research.
That's correct.
So you're agreeing one thing that Dave Emery says of Ranch America. Is that also Procter & Gamble? Because if you line up those moons in the Procter & Gamble symbol, it becomes 666. Is that part of it?
Watch for symbols of the sun and the moon. Procter & Gamble, the head of Procter & Gamble, was on a television talk show here in the United States, and he actually admitted that he had made a pact with the devil, and that's what made him rich. These secret societies actually worship the being called Lucifer.
Okay, winding up here, we have a question, another question for A.O. Chapman.
One thing, Mr. Cooper, I just wanted to ask this before we run out of time here, is with all the things that I've read from your stuff, if the most nightmare situation were to come true, from all the scenarios that you offer that may occur, what do you really advise to the average person? I mean, I recall reading the first time I ever read something yours, which was that secret document of the secret government essay you wrote. I felt quite paranoid after all that. I felt quite helpless.
Well, that's good. That's the defensive reaction.
Right, and so what do you prescribe as action to the person who now realizing this or now aware of it? What avenue should a person like me or anybody out there take?
Well, number one, they have to stop being deceived and learn what the truth is. Forget everything that you've ever been taught in your life, no matter who it was that taught it to you. Begin again, starting from scratch, doing real digging, real research, which is work, but it's also a lot of fun. And when you discover something that nobody else knows, it gives you a rush better than any drug that you could ever possibly take in your life. And learn what the truth is, because until you know what the truth is, there's nothing that you can do. That's number one, and that's got to be done. After you know the truth, and everybody who knows the truth, get together, band into politically powerful groups, and legally take action to change the world from where it's going to a better world.
Okay, are you taking any of those steps yourself right now? Or?
Absolutely. I've been doing this for a long time. I run probably the largest and most effective private intelligence organization in the world. I have millions of people all over the world that I've woken up and are doing their own research and are helping change things for the better.
A caller phoned in off the air and asked if you know anything about the Rael Alien, R-H-E-L Alien people.
Yeah, I know all about them.
Well, they just wondered what you thought of them.
I think it's the biggest bunch of bullshit I've ever heard in my life.
And what do they say? Because I'm not familiar with them.
Very simple. They're preaching Marxism.
Oh, and Marxism
one world,
is bad.
One world totalitarian socialist government. There's a vein running through every one of these people who claim that they have contact and are getting messages from extraterrestrials, including Billy Meyer, including the Rael group, including all of these people, the channelers, everything.
So
if you get at the major theme of what they're saying, it is socialism, Marxism, the elimination of private property, the bringing into the world of the communist dream.
Okay, well, yeah. Okay, that's your opinion, I guess. I'm not sure.
No, it's not opinion. It's actual fact.
Okay. Well, that's okay. Well, I guess the people at CITR, other people listening, might disagree with that. But anyways, moving away from that.
Well, wait a minute. Let's not move away from it. The fact that you're so eager to move away from it makes me eager to stay with it for just a few more minutes. Look at the document known as the Tenets of Communism that Marx wrote. Okay. It spells out in steps, step by step, what the doctrine of international socialism is.
Okay, how is communism...
If you compare those steps, what all these people are preaching, you'll find that there is no difference whatsoever. They're exactly the same. So it's not a theory. I'm not making this up. It's fact.
Okay, what's the difference between Freemasonry or the Illuminati and... Isn't there a big difference between Illuminati and communism?
They're all the same. Communism came from the Illuminati.
But one is the controller.
Oh, okay, so that's the communism came from the Illuminati. Okay, that's what I wanted to know. Earl Chapman, we have are you finished with your question?
I'm just going to hit him with one more question. Are all chapters of Freemasonry involved in this? It would seem that, to me, there would be a hierarchy of the
chapters. Absolutely. That's how they control stupid people. Most Freemasons are very stupid, and they are the greatest group of followers in the world.
So my friend's dad is a Freemason.
That's correct.
Well, we're going to try to do that, but I'm getting a lot of resistance from people who now say he's not only Hispanic, and he not only doesn't look too nice on TV, but he's too old. So my question to people is, well, if the only honest man in Congress is not worth running for president in the next election, then what the hell are you people all about? I mean, why am I trying to save you when you're just that lost? I mean, you want to go after Ross Perot, who's in the pocket of the Rockefellers. They made him. They created him. And all he's doing is working for their interests. He's a billionaire. He doesn't give a damn about the guy that makes $5 an hour. Okay. And never will.
Okay. Actually, he was involved with IBM, and I got sucked into going to
okay, that's cool. So
I broke my dad's wallet, and I've been pissed at the guy ever since.
We had a caller exploring off the air, and she asked, on the back of the American dollar bill, there's a pyramid.
Yes.
And the pyramid, and in Latin, it's written New World Order. Does that have anything to do with it?
Absolutely. The United States of America was founded by Freemasons, members of the Illuminati, for one purpose and one purpose only. It was an experiment in government to see if man could really rule himself or if he would have to be brought under control of those who can rule, and in the process topple the kings and queens of Europe off their thrones. Well, the experiment was successful in that it did topple the kings and queens off their thrones, but it has not been successful because man has abdicated his responsibility to rule himself, and the New World Order is going to put him in chains again.
Have there any been, Mr. Cooper, have there any been, with this kind of stuff you're talking about and the kind of people you're talking about, have there any been any threats on your life or even worried about your own personal security?
I've been threatened, I've been attacked, all kinds of things have happened to us, but that's not important to anybody out there. Anytime anyone stands up and fights for what is right, they're going to come under attack. And why would anybody care when they don't care about sending people to die in Iraq or Kuwait? I mean, nobody asked those guys that question.
Okay.
Here I am in my country really fighting for freedom, and everybody, the first thing they ask me, aren't you scared? And my question is, why don't you ask those guys that you're sending to die in the desert in the Middle East for something that has nothing to do with our freedom? Why aren't you asking them if they're scared?
These private armies, though, have tried on a couple of different occasions, it's mentioned in your book, that they tried to kill you on two separate occasions and came and visit you in the hospital and everything.
That's correct.
You were run off the road.
That's correct.
And one of them cost you your leg.
That's correct.
Well, thanks for speaking to us, Warden Cooper. Again, if you could give your address out and phone number, just the people that are listening that are interested.
Well, first I'd like to say this. Don't be too concerned about my health or what happens to me, because I really believe in what I'm doing, number one. And number two, I believe that any man or woman on the face of this earth who does not have principles that they're ready and willing to die for at any given moment, in my estimation, are already dead or of no use or consequence to anybody. If you guys like to call Stan, call 602-567-6109. That's 602-567-6109. Or you can write to Stan and ask for a packet of information at Post Office Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's P.O. Box 889, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. And I might add that you people in Canada, you've already lost your constitution, you've already lost your freedoms, you're already in the New World Order, and there's some really strange things going on up there that you better get a handle on real quick.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Cooper. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
And keep on rocking in a free world.
Thank you, and God bless you and your listeners.
Okay. Do-do-do-do. So that was William Cooper live on the phone, and me and Ron are paying for this, right, Ron?
Yeah.
So that was how long?
Pretty much.
An hour?
It's supposed to be half an hour, and we pushed that for probably almost an hour, so...
And Ron, you're from the Rock and Roll Band Cats game. You were transformed.
And Active Glands.
We played some Active Glands earlier on in the show here today. There's one last thing that you want to say about William Cooper. I understand it a bit better. What about you, A.O.? Do you understand that? It's different from what he said the first time, wasn't it?
A slightly different impression. He was a little bit more clear. I was pleased to hear him.
Remember the first time when we saw that, we gave that document, it said like all these aliens were coming down and that Kennedy was killed by the driver and all this stuff. Was like, geez, he believes in aliens, but now he's saying, no, aliens don't exist. We just have the technology and it was developed by Hitler. And it's a hoax in order to get everybody in the world scared because the Illuminati are going to take over. Did you understand that?
I understand what he was saying. But from the original secret government document.
But why did he put out that document, I'm wondering?
I don't know. I guess his point to me was just that he was saying, well, this is what I saw. It's not necessarily true.
But this is what I saw, and then followed it up.
I don't believe him actually saying that in the secret government file. Maybe he did. It's been a while since I've read it.
Some of that communism, like, I mean, come on, Ron, you being from the punk rock Active Glands, who for years sung about, you know, perhaps to praise some socialist values in your songs, have you become are you like a born-again Christian commie? Anti-communist, anti-socialist now?
Not yet. Actually, what I've begun to do is... Listen. Since I became I'm not an agent of William Cooper by any stretch of the imagination, I'm just really interested in what he has to say. And some of the things that I have seen on his video cassettes and what I have read in his book, which is entitled Behold a Pale Horse, and which I think any breathing, thinking human being should order this book from Stan, because I don't want to have to come in here and sit here and tell you about it. I want everybody out there to read this and make up your own minds, and then you won't have to listen to me, and you won't have to listen to all the mindless blabber that goes on. Get the book.
Okay.
He's got another 7-hour video cassette coming up. 7 hours! I mean, this guy is on 5 nights a week. He's been on for, like, months and months and years since, like, May 4th, 1990. He started going on the air, and that's putting on 3 hours, at least to 5 hours a week of information every week. And, I mean, how can we get any information out of this guy in 1 hour and have to yell at him from three different positions?
Okay.
It's stupid.
Okay, well, Ron, thanks for coming, anyways.
Oh, that's okay. I need a beer.
Okay, well, just a second, Ron. Just a second. I'm saying about socialism. Has your views changed on socialism?
I like my welfare check.
Also, that's good. Thank you very much, Ron. 1998, he says that's going to be the date, right?
Brilliant.
Right?
1998 has several... Okay, first of all, in the book Holy Blood, Holy Grail by Bajon Lee and Lincoln, there's a list of...